back, call us on 0808-054-2233. That's 0808-054-2233 for questions you have on pneumonia. And you can also tweet at @CTV_MaryA. We were talking about prevention. Health education primarily.
Yes. Vaccination also absolutely essential. In the developed world, Haemophilus influenza, which is a bacteria, used to be a really common cause of bacterial pneumonias. However, they barely record, you know, such cases. Even if you do see cases of, you know, Haemophilus influenza pneumonia, it's possible that the person had come from a region where widespread immunization was not available. However, the federal government of Nigeria, in its national program on immunization, has recognized that the vaccines to prevent Haemophilus influenza pneumonia, as well as Streptococcus pneumonia,
the pneumonias
it has been included in the national program on immunization schedule. However, it's not really being subsidized like the other ones, you know, but awareness is being created about the fact that immunization is absolutely essential. Exclusive breastfeeding is paramount. Avoidance of malnutrition, good nutrition. And so, of course, with good nutrition, it's just not one sector, because the agricultural sector has to be working perfectly for you to have food security and for you to have children who eat well. There has to be good for financial status for the parents, and housing is absolutely essential, because overcrowding is one of the reasons why children come down with pneumonias. And so housing also comes into play with, so that overcrowding is avoided. So those are some of the things that can help us to prevent pneumonias.
Now, are you saying that one vaccine takes care of all the pneumonias?
Well, unfortunately, that really isn't the case. I wish there was a one-stop-shop vaccine to take care of all the pneumonias, but there aren't. Because the organisms that cause pneumonias are as varied as their mechanisms of causing the pneumonias, you need different vaccines. But vaccines need to be developed in a practical way, such that the organisms that are most common are the organisms for which vaccines are developed. So, Haemophilus influenza, as I've mentioned before, has a vaccine which is now in the MPI as part of the pentavalent vaccine series.
What is it called?
It's called HIV, Haemophilus influenza type
HIV.
B vaccine. Yes. It's called the pentavalent vaccine. It contains five vaccines. It contains diphtheria, pertussis, and tetanus vaccine, as well as the hepatitis B. And
so it's not DPT anymore?
It's not just DPT anymore. It's not the pentavalent vaccine. So it's okay. DPT plus hepatitis B and the Haemophilus influenza type B vaccine. And so that prevents pneumonia. Then you have the pneumococcal vaccine, which prevents pneumonia against 13 serotypes of the pneumonia.
That's good. 13?
Yes, 13.
Let's take this call from William. Hello, William.
Hello, good morning.
Good morning, William. What's your question?
Good morning, Dr. Rana.
A very good morning to you, William.
Nice to have sort of pneumonia and everything. I would like to know, with regard to the vaccines, how often is it something, is it a one-time thing, or is it something that has to be topped over and over again from time to time? Or is it like, you know, once it's been given at a particular stage in a child's life or in a person's life, then you're free for all time?
Thank you, William. That's a brilliant question.
Thank you very much, William, for the question. It really does bring to mind the essence of repeated visits to the hospital. So, for instance, the pneumococcal vaccine, you know, because the streptococcus pneumonia, as I said, is a very common cause of bacterial pneumonia. For the MPI, it's taken thrice, at 6 weeks, at 10 weeks, and at 14 weeks. And so, usually for those vaccines, there are three doses, and the interval is about 4 weeks between each of them. After that, then protection is pretty much lifelong.
But 900,000 deaths in 2015. Mm. Why so many?
Now, this is a worldwide figure, and most of these deaths, if you go into the archives, you realize are in developing countries. Now, developing countries have the challenges that we are all too aware of. So there's a lack of access to good health care. When they do have access to health care in the health facilities, there's lack of access to things like respiratory support or anything. As the child comes in and is having extreme difficulty with breathing and you want to ventilate the child with a mechanical ventilator, you absolutely can't. And so a lot of support, and you know, sometimes even when they get to the hospital, there's barely enough money for them to actually pay for the services that they need. And somehow, those are the children that actually make it to the hospital. Those 990,000, you know, those are the children that make it to the hospitals. There are some that, you know, they never really make it to the hospital. And possibly that is the majority of people that are actually dying. So it's really the problem of the developing world.
Okay, Anne is calling us from Bagada. Hello, Anne.
Hello, good morning.
Good morning, Anne. Good
morning, Anne.
I'm actually interested in the discussion going on. I'd like to ask the doctor, can you just tell me the cause of frequent sneezing? Frequent sneezing. When a child is sneezing frequently without a kind of, I don't know what just to call it. I've been administering Otrivine, but the sneezing continues. Do I call that pneumonia or something more than that?
Yeah, thank you, Anne. Does she call that pneumonia?
Thank you.
Frequent sneezing.
Thank you very much, Anne. This is a mini consultation, but I will oblige you. So, when a child sneezes frequently, there are a lot of things that come to our head. Of course, the first question we ask is, why is that happening? Now, I mean, the commonest reason why a child would sneeze would be the fact that the child has an upper respiratory tract infection, such as the common cold.
However, really? Not just an irritation?
The common cold, if really it's just, if it's happening, for instance, very frequently, it's possible that this is, how often would, you know, the child get irritated by something? Most likely common cold. If we're thinking about any infectious cause, then we're thinking about the common cold. Irritation is a possibility, but if we're thinking of an infectious cause, then we're thinking of a viral upper respiratory tract infection. However, if this is something that has been going on for a long time, say every morning for the last 1 month, for the last 3 months, the child has been waking up and sneezing, rubbing the nose, then you're thinking along the lines of allergic disease. Allergic disease, so for instance, allergic rhinitis. And usually with allergic rhinitis, there's probably a family history of maybe a parent or a sibling having similar symptoms where they're constantly sneezing.
So pneumonia will not be the first thing on the line?
No, pneumonia would not be
the
first thing.
Not even the second thing you'd be thinking of?
No, very far down the line. You know, eventually the sneezing might result in a pneumonia, but that's not the usual course of things. So if you chronic sneezing, think about an allergic condition. And then Otrivine might not do so much if it's allergic rhinitis, and so I would suggest that you go to the hospital and you probably see an ENT who will give you some advice on what to do for allergic rhinitis.
Okay, thank you so much. Now, you spoke about overcrowding. Some things cannot be avoided. Some families don't have enough money for enough space, so they're crowded. Is there anything they can do to reduce the incidence or the likelihood of getting pneumonia?
Okay. The responsibility for housing primarily lies on the government at every level, so the local government, state government, and the federal government. And so advocacy has to be made by groups who realize the importance and how much pneumonias are costing the country. Because sometimes what politicians need to hear is how much in terms of dollars this condition is costing productivity in a country. And this is the future that we are losing, actually. And so we need to tell the government that, look, this needs to happen. Now, for people who don't have any other source and who absolutely must sleep in an overcrowded place, if anybody has a respiratory tract infection, any adult specifically has a respiratory tract infection, as much as possible, they should just try to avoid contact with the children. And if you're getting a place, try to make sure that you have what you call cross-ventilation. Cross-ventilation means that there are two windows opposite one another, such that air flows from one end of the room to the other end of the room, not door and window opposite each other, because you find out that the door is shut half the time, and so whatever air is coughed out remains
goes out of the house.
If there are two windows, so it's cross ventilation.
Okay, let's take a break now.
Okay,
we'll go on a short break and be back in almost no time. Stay with us.